into this place, Lord, where you're at, Lord, and to feel your mighty spirit, God. Lord, we pray for those that are sick, Lord, those that are struggling, those that can't be here, whether they're traveling or because of some other reason. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would touch and bless and heal in that mighty name which is above every name, that name of Jesus. And we continue to pray for those that are suffering, those that are fighting different diseases and sicknesses, whether it be cancer or some other type of disease. We pray in that mighty name, the name which is above every name, the name of Jesus. And Lord, let your mercy and your grace flow in this place today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And so those that are here today, our teachers and our students, you're dismissed. Don't look like we have a whole lot today. Amen. Maybe they'll come trickling in. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. We're going to get into the adult lesson. And the adult lesson is basically a foundation for the message later on in our worship service. And I think that I need to lay this foundation. I think it's a topic that many people misunderstand, it sounds like sometimes the Bible is speaking and it's not real clear on some things, or people misinterpret it. We talk about the grace of God. You know, some people say we're saved by God's grace, which is true. If it wasn't for God's grace, we would have no hope. We would have no direction. We would have no plan. We would have no word. We would have no plan of salvation. And so it's God's grace that he has given us a plan. And so what I want to talk about is, I want you to look at it this way. If somebody gives you a free gift, if I give you a free gift, you can only receive that free gift if you have an open hand, if you receive it. So I can put a gift up here and say, here's a free gift, but you're not going to receive it just because I gave you a free gift unless you do something to receive the free gift. And so that's kind of the way I kind of picture God's grace. It's a free gift, and it is for everyone, but if you don't receive the gift, if you don't come with an open hand and you don't respond and receive it, then it's really... It's not just God's grace and everybody's saved and I don't have to do anything. I don't have to believe. I don't have to repent. I don't have to serve. I don't have to do anything because God's grace. You know, I would like for that to be true. I would hope and pray that everybody's going to go to heaven because of God's grace. I mean, that would be ideal, wouldn't it? I would still serve God even if I didn't have to do anything. I appreciate that God's grace came and gave me a plan and changed my life. And so I would serve him anyway. But I don't think it works quite like that. God's grace is free, yes. He gave us a free gift if we come with open hands to receive it and take it. And so I want to lay a foundation for the second message. And so it's all tied in to receive a gift, you must open your hand. And so this topic today in the Sunday school lesson is the grace of God. And the scripture I want to use is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 10. Now I'm going to read chapter 15, verses 1 through 12, but I want to read 10 first just to kind of put you into a place where we're going. The Apostle Paul wrote that by God's grace, he or I am what I am because of God's grace. So I am what I am, you are what you are because of God's grace. If it had not been for God's grace, where would I be? Where would you be? And so, yes, it's God's grace. Thank God for his grace. But somebody had to receive the grace so that God can change my life, change your life, change anyone's life. And so let's read from verse 1. And it reads like this: Moreover, brethren and sisters, I declare unto you the gospel, which I preached unto you, the Apostle Paul writing to the Corinthian church, which also you have received. You received it. It wasn't just there. It wasn't that I just preached it, but you received it. And so we can have a free gift. Listen, our salvation is free, but we've got to receive it. And so he said, I preached to you and you received it. And wherein you stand. Because you received it, you stand in it. Right? You trust it. You obey it. You put it into action. You apply it to your life. Because I preached it and you received it, now you're standing in it. In verse 2, by which also you are saved. You're saved not because of God's grace only, but because you received the preaching that I preached. If you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. So you can say you believe and that you received, but if you don't keep it and keep it in memory and apply it, then it's in vain. Say amen. And so, by which also you are saved, if you keep in memory, which I preached unto you, unless it have been and you believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received. So I delivered to you that which I received. So the grace of God that came into my life that I received, and now that I preach to you that free gift, God's grace, I'm preaching it and you received it because I received it first and I'm sharing it with you. Hallelujah. And it said how that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture. God's grace is that he came and wrapped himself in the flesh. He was born of a virgin. He walked on this earth. He felt our temptations. He knows everything we go through. But he gave himself and he died on the cross. He shed his blood so that we could have salvation. That's his grace. Grace alone wasn't it. He had to do something to apply the grace. And so he died according to the scriptures. How many of you believe the scriptures? You've got to receive the scriptures. And he was buried, and that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures. According to the scripture. The scripture is the grace. The grace is that God gave us scripture. God gave us the plan. God gave us the hope. God tells us everything we need to know. That's the grace of God. Not just God's grace, and we don't have to receive anything. We don't have to do anything. We don't have to read anything. We don't have to apply anything. No, God's grace says, here is the plan. Say amen. For grace is given not because we have done good works. Grace is not given because we have done great works. None of us got saved because of our works. It was God's grace that drew us. It was God's grace that we suffered so that we would be drawn to him. I don't know about you, but I didn't come to Christ until I suffered. It was the suffering that made me look up and look for a hope. And then when I found it, the grace came. And when I repented, grace said, okay, I receive it. I forgive you. Now wash yourself. Now here's my spirit. It was the grace of God that caused me to suffer, to be drawn to him so that I would do something to receive it. But it wasn't because of my great works. But in order that we may be able to do them. Hallelujah. Grace is, hey, my mercy is there. I'm going to cover you. I'm going to wash you. I'm going to give you a plan so that you can do them. That's the grace of God. Not, my grace is sufficient. You don't have to do anything. No, my grace ought to cause you to want to do something. My grace ought to cause you want to share and to pray and to be obedient and to follow me and to trust me and to be like me. My grace ought to make you want to do something. Well, grace was in all her steps. Watch this. Came from heaven And every gesture that grace gives us, it's the dignity of love. It's because of his love that he had grace on us, that he gave us a plan to be redeemed. And oftentimes our suffering is redemptive. It brings us to God so we can receive grace. Grace doesn't depend on suffering exactly to exist, but where there is suffering, you will find God's grace in many different facets, in many different colors of life. Listen, our suffering, God's grace is there. It doesn't have to exist to receive God's grace, but many times it does exist, and we feel God's grace because of our suffering. And that he was seen by the 12. And verse 6 says, and that he was seen above by 500 brethren all at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, as he was writing, but some are fallen asleep. Means they have passed on. In verse 7, after that he was seen by James. And then he was seen by all the apostles. And then in verse 8, and last of all, he was seen by me, the Apostle Paul, who is writing, as one that was born out of due time. For I am the least of all the apostles, that am not meant to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God, but because of God's grace. God's grace, hallelujah, even though I don't deserve it, even though I was doing the wrong things, I was persecuting the church, but because of God's grace, I received the plan. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. Listen, it wasn't because of something I did, but because of God's grace, and God called me, and I received it. It's that kind of grace. It's the grace of God that gave me, allowed me an opportunity to receive grace. See, many people get this confused. Well, we're saved by grace. That means I don't have to do anything. You ought to want to do something because of God's grace. And his grace, which was bestowed upon me, was not in vain. But I labored. What did he do? He labored. Well, his grace, I don't have to do anything. No, I labor for him because of his grace. I'm so thankful. I so appreciate. I want to labor for him because of his grace. Oh, hallelujah. Getting quiet out there in TV land. Hallelujah. I labored more abundantly. Because of his grace, I labored more abundantly. The Apostle Paul used to labor hard, but now he says, I labor abundantly because of his grace. Then they all, yet not I, but it's the grace of God which was with me that helped me abundantly serve him and labor for him. In verse 11, it says, therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so you believed. We labor and we preach the gospel. Why? So that you can receive it, that you can believe it. By God's grace, the word is preached so that you can hear it, so that you can believe it, so you can receive it, and you can receive the grace of God. In verse 12, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how can we say some among you how can you say there is no resurrection? How can you say there is no resurrection? Apparently people were saying there was no resurrection. But if there be no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. And if Christ be not risen, then it is our preaching that is in vain. And your faith is also in vain. If you believe what I'm preaching, it's all in vain if there was no resurrection. And yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified that God had risen up, hallelujah, whom he raised not up, if so be that he is dead and he has not risen. And so what we preach God's grace, we preach his death, his burial, his resurrection. Listen, this is the example. This is the pattern. It's the death, it's the burial, it's the resurrection. That's God's grace. God gave us the plan, the death, the burial, the resurrection. So the grace of God is here. We're going to preach the death, burial, and resurrection. We're going to preach, die to yourself, repent. Be baptized, be buried in what? With him, in his name. And ye shall also be resurrected, and God will give you a new, hallelujah, give you a new life. Woo. Glory. Amen. Amen. And so we have that same spirit. We die, we're buried with him, we take on his name, he gives us his spirit, and we have a new life. All things become new. Hallelujah. So if we look here and we see grace is a gift from God, but to receive this free gift, we must have open hands to receive it. We're not going to get the free gift if we don't receive it. He once explained that the crowds who attended his services, oh, I forgot his name. There was a gentleman who had services, John Newton. He once said that people, crowds would come to attend his service, but they came not to hear him preach the gospel, but he was a lion tamer in a circus. So they would come to see him tame the lions, but not hear the gospel of Christ. And so we see that the Apostle Paul talked about God's grace, how it changed his life. God's grace saved his soul. He disciplined his mind. He enriched his life. He empowered his ministry, and he sustained him until the end of time. He says, what I am is because of the grace of God. I have become what God wants me to be because of his grace. Say amen. And so we need to see here that every Christian must say this. We need God's grace. We need God's grace. But we have to receive it. It's not just God's grace and I can ignore him. I don't have to respond to him. I don't have to repent. I don't have to be baptized. I don't have to receive his spirit. I don't have to follow him. I don't have to obey him. I don't need to hear his word. His grace is sufficient for me. Hallelujah. Let's look at this. Five things that we need to note here. Number one, we are saved by God's grace, because if it wasn't for God and his plan, we would have no hope. In 1 John chapter 4, 19, he said, he first loved us. He first loved us. What did he do? He laid down his life for us. That's what love does. When you can receive God's love and his grace, then you're going to lay down your life for him. He became our replacement for sin. He became the substitute for our sin. He said that he loved us first for, why? For our sins, he laid down his life. Ephesians chapter 2, 8 said it this way, for by grace you are saved. We did not deserve to be saved. None of us deserve to be saved. It's only by his grace that he put a plan together to save us. We cannot secure salvation of ourselves. We have to have God's grace. People were not saved by their works in the Old Testament or in the New Testament. It's God's grace. God has always dealt with his people through being graceful and forgiving and merciful and loving and giving of himself. Let me say it this way. Grace means that all of your past mistakes now serve a purpose. All of our mistakes, past, even present, and even future. They all still have a purpose. We apply God's grace. Now we don't serve our mistakes. We serve grace. We serve God because of His grace instead of our mistakes. Let me say, this is how Amos, when he preached to his people, some people say, well, God saved His people by grace. Yes, this is true, but watch this. Amos chapter 5, verse 15, watch how he says this. Amos urged his people to repent. Why would he urge them to repent? We're saved by grace. If I'm saved by grace, why do I do anything? No, God's grace is God's calling you and giving you a way to be cleansed, to be washed, to be delivered, to be saved. Amos urged his people to repent and walk in the right way with the hope that the Lord Jesus or the Lord God of the Old Testament, the host, will be gracious. In other words, you can't just take grace. You got to receive it. How do you receive it? You got to have an open hand. You've got to repent. You got to walk with Him. You've got to trust Him. Then grace comes. Because when you believe and you come and you repent and you follow God, now grace is applied. If I could go to Romans chapter, I think it's 7, where it talks about how they understood the law when he was talking to the Israelites and the people that understood the law. He said that a woman cannot remarry until her husband dies, and then she can remarry. And what he's saying to the church is, you can't serve, you can't get married to God, you can't be the bride of Christ until what? Until that other one dies. You can't receive that. You can't be married until what? Until you get rid. The other one is dead. So we've got to die to self before we can marry our groom. And we'll talk about that more in detail later. It's found in Romans. And he's talking to the people about the law. It's not everybody saved just because God wants to save them. The grace comes in that here's the plan. You got to first die. The old man's got to die. The sinful nature has to die. Before you can receive grace, you've got to ask, Lord, I want to change. I'm dying to self. I want to be married to You. I want to follow You. I want to trust You. I want to obey You. I trust You. Amos urged his people, repent and walk in the right way with the hope that God will be gracious. And God is gracious if we can just simply repent and walk with Him. Paul's testimony was, by grace of God, I am what I am. That's all we all are. None of us would be anything without God's grace. But it took each and every one of us to receive that gift by coming to the altar and repenting and start, what? Meditating on God, following God, trusting God, trying to get better at what God wants us to do. That's why we have grace. I know we're not saved by our works, but guess what? When grace comes in, love comes in, what happens is all of a sudden works do follow. Works without, what is it? Faith without works is dead. So we work because of our faith. We work because of His grace. We're not trying to earn salvation. It's His salvation was a free gift, but we have to receive it. Hope this is making sense. I know that some people get confused with this. Once saved, always saved. Well, that's not exactly what the Bible says. He talked about backbiters and backsliders burning in the lake of fire. Well, how could they be backbiters and backsliders if they never believed? So it's not once you believe, always saved. To receive grace, you have to have an open hand to receive it. When we think of what he was, the apostle Paul, he was a blasphemer. He was a persecutor. He was a destroyer of the churches. And when we think of what he became, an apostle to the Gentiles and to the Jews, a missionary, a statesman, he was a founder of churches. He was a soul winner. What made the difference? Grace. But he had to receive it. If he never received it, there would never have been a change. You can't apply grace to your life without change, without receiving the grace that comes from God. There can be but one answer to this, and this is the grace of God. Of course, we are disciplined by God's grace. We are disciplined. Let me get a hold of this. We are disciplined because of God's grace. God's grace allows us to be disciplined. If we didn't have God's grace, he would just say, "You're an idiot. Poof. You're done. Be gone." But because of his grace, he tugs at our heart. He says, "Come, come to the altar. Come, repent. Give me your sins. Let me wash your sins. Let me apply grace to you." So when we have discipline to follow God, that's grace. God gives us the time to change and to get discipline to follow him. Because even after we have the Holy Ghost, even after we've been baptized, we make mistakes. Thank God for discipline. Thank God that God puts a little conviction in our heart so that we can change and apply grace again. You can apply grace once, and then you go out and you forget about God and you do your own thing. Then grace is not applied anymore. Thank God for discipline. The words discipline and disciple come from the same root word. You've got to be someone who wants to be taught. You've got to be someone who wants to be disciplined in what you learn. There can be no discipleship without discipline. God cannot disciple you without your discipline to follow him. Cheap grace is grace without discipleship. Grace without the cross. Grace without Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, God's grace, quite simply, is God's mercy and God's goodness toward us. It's his goodness and his mercy toward us that we can receive mercy so that we can want to follow him, so that he can disciple us, so that we can be disciplined in our attitudes and our actions, so that we can apply God's word to our life because we know that it's going to benefit us. It's not God trying to control us. It's his grace that says, "Here's a better plan. This is what you ought to do. This will make things better if you learn to forgive, if you learn to lay down your life, if you learn to trust me, if you learn to obey me. These things will make you better. And I can discipline you, or I can disciple you because of your discipline, because you're disciplined enough to want to receive my grace." Hope it's making sense to somebody. We cannot be saved by our discipline alone, but our salvation cannot be effective unless we are disciplined. Let me say that again. I think that went over everybody's head. We cannot be saved by our discipline, but our salvation cannot be as effective if we're not disciplined. Paul put the two together like this: "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world." Titus chapter 2, verse 11 and 12. Paul was saying God's grace saves us. God's grace teaches us. And on one hand, he said that we need to realize that God's grace has given us a plan to receive righteousness. When we can understand that God's not trying to control. God's trying to benefit us. God's trying to bless us. And what he's trying to do is get you to believe that so that you can reap the benefits by applying his grace to your life and learning that grace teaches you. Oh, hallelujah. What does it teach you? To deny ungodliness? I got to stay there for just a minute. Everybody pay attention. He said that if God's grace, if we really apply God's grace to our lives, it will teach us to avoid ungodliness. To deny it. To avoid it. Not to want to be part of it. It will help us live soberly and righteously and what? And holy or godly in this present world. God's grace does that for us. But if we don't receive it, we act like heathens. We want to be ungodly. We don't want to be sober. We want to participate in worldly things. Thank God for his grace, though. And so grace ought to teach us that, oh, God loves me so much. His grace is applied. If I just come and I repent and I try to walk after him, his grace will cover me and he will apply it to my life and I will change and I will be godly and holy and I will live a righteous life. Which we ought to be thankful. Why does anybody want to live an ungodly life? And I'm going to say it again. Even if God's grace was enough and I didn't have to do anything, I still want to do what I'm doing because of his grace. Paul was saying God's grace saves us. God's grace teaches us. He said, a truly disciplined Christian emerges by grace, the grace of God. It's God's grace that he allows us to not let the devil beat us down. Well, you know you didn't do everything right, but no, God's grace says, I forgive you. I'm teaching you. I'm training you. You're my disciple. I know you're not going to get everything right, but my grace is going to help you, going to teach you. It's going to make you more righteous. It's going to be more of a blessing. It's a privilege to live after what I say. It's God's grace. Because if it wasn't for God's grace, every time we did something wrong, he said, well, you don't deserve to be in church. You need to just get out. Brother Bobby has a testimony here. Before we start our service, I want him to come up and testify. God is good, and God's mercy and God's grace, it extends. Oh, man, it extends to those that receive it. Let me look at the third thing here. Oh, I need to close here. We are enriched by God's grace. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, 9 says, Paul told the Corinthians, for ye know that the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor. That what? That you through his poverty might be rich. He gave his life for you so that you can have abundant life. Because of his grace. 2 Corinthians 12:19 says it this way. Each time he said, my grace is all you need. My power works best in you when you are weak. So now I am glad. The Apostle Paul said, now I am glad. And I boast about my weakness because my weakness makes me strong through God's grace. Let's stand. We are empowered by God's grace. You know what our favorite fruit should be? Spiritual fruit. Say amen. We have the daycare, the nursery, right? You know, if Jesus, when he was a baby and he was going to the nursery, you know what song they would sing the most? Mary had a little lamb, God's grace. God's grace gave us the lamb, gave us the sacrifice, gave us the replacement for our sins. That was God's grace. God's grace gave us a plan. He became the sacrifice. He became the little lamb that takes away the sins of the world. God's grace. Paul did receive a promise, however, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness. And the last thing I just want to touch on, we are sustained by his grace. We are sustained by his grace. Not only does God give us strength each and every day by his grace, it sustains us through every trial, every tribulation, every pitfall, every attack of the enemy. His grace is sufficient, and his grace, what? It supplies our needs, and it sustains us. Let's lift up our hands right now. Brother Bobby is going to come, and he's going to share a great testimony of God's grace. Hallelujah. Brother Bobby, hallelujah, glory to God. Brother Bobby, he was saved in an apostolic Pentecostal church in, what was it, Brazil, right? Amen. I know you're originally from Terre Haute, Indiana, but he went to Brazil. And the reason he went to the Brazilian church was because his sons were in the summer camp, what they call it, vacation Bible school. And so he came to see the award, the ceremony, and in that ceremony, he got saved. Hallelujah. God's grace. Amen. I want Brother Bobby to come, and I want him to close this message and start our service today with a great, great, great testimony. Many of us know his son. He was here for a little while. Great drummer. Amen. And we're glad to hear about this testimony.
Praise the Lord. I remember in 1989, July 31st, that was a Tuesday night service, and it was pretty cold. The water was pretty cold because back then they lit the fire on the hot water heater, and you waited that, and then that water would go in, then you wait for the next one to come in, and the water wasn't very warm, so I got the Holy Ghost pretty quick. Stammering lips was no problem. But anyway, I was a single parent, had two sons that I've been raising by myself. And the funny thing about it is their mother grew up in an apostolic church. Because of her mother, their grandmother, took them to church and took them to the vacation Bible school. And I didn't know what God had planned for me. You know, here I flew all the way from Austin, Texas to get my kids, and you know, we were going back to Texas, and I had no plans to stay in Brazil, Indiana. I was going back to Texas, play music, you know, have my fun. But my life was in shambles. I hated my life, really.
Yeah, come on.
I didn't have no joy. Can't get joy from the world. It's only a little joy. So when I went to that the vacation Bible school thing, Sister Hunt preached that morning. It was a Sunday morning. And they were giving out the awards. And when she started preaching, I ran to the altar and cried out to God, do something. And that Tuesday, the next Tuesday, right after that Sunday school, I got the revelation on a Monday. I was getting ready to go get drunk because my grandfather was dying in the VA, and I went to see him before he died. He was like my father. And so the devil was going, well, you might as well go get drunk. God can't help you now. And I got to the door of the tavern, and all of a sudden it hit me. It was all in the name of Jesus. All I was doing the whole time was praying in the name of Jesus. And how come the devil's trying to get me go in that tavern and get drunk? Because of the name? I said, there's something to this. So on Monday, I told Brother Hunt, I said, I got to be baptized in Jesus' name. Big old smile come on his face. And he said, okay, we'll do it Tuesday night. And I got baptized Tuesday night, got the Holy Ghost in the water. And it changed my life. I stayed in Brazil for 20-something years and served just about everything except for being a pastor. I did every job. I took the trash out, scrubbed the toilets, you know, and I stayed there until they died and I met this man here, and it was God that put me and him together. And when he said he was from Indiana, I said, oh, this has got to be God. And then he plays basketball, and he's from Park County. I thought, you know. So my two sons was in the church all their lives. I raised them. I even left one on the pew one time. I had to go back and get them. But I'm going to tell you something. It was worth it all. You know, you get at my age, you get to the point where you think you're not any good for God anymore. You can't do nothing. So you want to just sit back, lay back. And reap all the blessings of God because you did it all already. You know, hey, I've served you already for 20 years. I'm getting old. I can't, you know, do all the things you want me to do. He said, uh-uh.
That's right.
And so out of the blue, I started doing something for God.
Yeah.
And guess what? When you pray for somebody else's child, and when you fast for somebody else's child, and you befriend somebody else's child and you work with them, the youth pastor, my Miguel, when he does stuff like that, and you minister, you're not doing it for nothing. You're doing it for somebody, because God is using you for somebody else. Even though my son wasn't living with me, Robert wasn't living with me, and he was doing all the bad things that he could get himself into trouble. He his hair was so long and his hair all over him. They thought he was a terrorist one time for the Taliban. He looked like the Taliban. And this morning I have a picture of him, and it doesn't even look like the same kid. And he says, Dad, I'm back in. Tell you another little story. I don't mean to take so long. I didn't even know I was going to come up here, but I got my number one son. I got number one, number two, but they're both number one in my life. You know how your children are. They mean everything to you. And I got one more son, but his wife grew up in the apostolic faith, right, in a church across town. But every time they're both backslidden, every time they would come to church, you got it. Keep asking your kids to come to church, because one time they're going to be like me and drop in for good. But every time that I would ask them to come to church on Sunday, why don't you come to church, you know, they would come. They would sit way in the back, and the preacher would start, and her name is Nikki, and all of a sudden she'd get up and she'd start walking towards the altar. And she'd get down on the altar and begin to cry. And God filled her with the Holy Ghost. Every time they came. And my son would sit on the front row or the back row and be so mad. You could see his face get so red because here his girlfriend was getting filled with the Holy Ghost. And he didn't want nothing to do with it. But they both got the Holy Ghost when they were 6 and 5. So when God gets a hold of you, let me tell you, He's gonna keep a hold of you until you're in this. Once you get in this thing, you're in it for life. It's like joining. You can't get away. My son kept telling me, Dad, I don't know why, but God keeps talking to me. That's because of our prayers. When our kids tell us God is still talking to me, there's still a chance that if we keep praying and don't give up. That's the thing. You can't give up, because once you give up, the devil gets a hold, a bigger hold. God bless y'all. Thank you for listening to me in Jesus' name.
Amen. It's called God's grace. And when they open up their hands to receive it, God is a merciful God. Hallelujah. All you got to do is reach out. Hallelujah. God's grace is there if we'll just receive it. Amen. Amen. Thank God for Robert and getting back and receiving that grace. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord.
To your neighbor and tell them, I'm here to praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm here to praise his name. He's a mighty God. If you could see all the things that he's done, all the testimonies in this place, what a mighty God we serve. Could we just raise our hands and lift our hands to the mighty God? Hallelujah, 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 Jesus, hallelujah.
What a mighty God. Lord, you're mighty.
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 Oh, 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 oh.
Lord, you're mighty.
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 Jesus, come on, we lift our holy hands unto you, God. You are worthy.
What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah.
He's a mighty God.
Amen. 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 We have a long list of people we're praying for today. Amen. Before we started church. Amen. Well, God must have moved upon Brother Chris. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Amen. He's here. Hallelujah. I like it when they say, I'm not going to be there, but they come anyway. Hallelujah. I'd rather them say, I'm not coming and come than say, I'm coming and they don't come. Amen. Where's Madison? Madison, will you come up here for a minute? I got a free gift. I got a free gift for you. Well, do you want a free gift? You don't want a free gift? There's my point altogether in my lesson today. Not everybody wants a free gift. Amen. You don't want a free gift? Well, she don't want it. I'm not going to give it to her.
She wants it.
Do you want a free gift? All right, come right here. Close your eyes. Hold out your hand. There's your free gift. Kimley, you want a free gift? Close your eyes. Hold out your hand. There's your free gift. Where's Kenna Drew? Kenna Drew, you want a free gift? No, she don't want a free gift. Not going to give free gifts. They don't want it. Amen. Amen. I don't know. Anybody want a free gift? Yeah, she likes free gifts. Amen. Look at that. You can come and get a free gift if you come and receive it. Come on up here. You want to receive? I only got a couple more.
Come on, Jacob.
Oh, Lord. Woo. There you go. Free gift. Free gift. This is how God works. Free gift. Hallelujah. Free gift. Last free gift. Who's got her hand out? She's got her hand out. Hallelujah. Amen. Grace is a free gift.
Amen.
We serve a mighty God. But you can't receive grace if you don't come and put your hand out to receive it. Amen. Amen. Sorry to interrupt, but I just felt like I want to illustrate that. Grace is there for us. It's a free gift, but you got to receive it. Amen. Amen.
Amen. What a good illustration, Pastor. The only thing I would say with the Lord is he never runs out. We can keep coming back, and he'll never run out. Aren't you so thankful for our Lord? I was thinking, as Brother Bobby was sharing his testimony this morning of what God is doing in Robert's life, I was thinking, my God, what a wonderful testimony, amen, that you just can't outgive the Lord, Brother Bobby. You're out there praying for somebody else's child. You're out there ministering to somebody else's family members, loved ones that have gone astray, perhaps. Not to receive something, right? But because that's what the Lord has called us to do. You just can't outgive God. While Brother Bobby's out there ministering in the park to those who are down and out, the Lord says, hey, I see Robert. I'm going to move in Robert's life. I remember a time in my life that I was much like Robert, and I didn't like hearing what Pastor just said. Once the Lord has marked you, you're marked for life. I didn't like hearing that. I wanted to do my own thing. Oh, somebody hear me. But I'm so thankful. I am so thankful that the Lord kept calling. So moms and dads, grandmas, grandpas, whoever you are, don't give up. Just begin. Keep speaking the name of Jesus over your child. right now. Why don't we do that all over this building? Begin to speak the name of Jesus. Come on. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Come on, speak the name. Speak the name, Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. And I just want to speak the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom, I speak Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows. Darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. For my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Yes, Jesus.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Break every
stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Presence. I speak Jesus. Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Sing Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Sing with us.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Somebody shout the name of Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, hallelujah. Jesus, Jesus, at the sound of that name, every demon has to flee. Every sickness must bow down at the sound of the name of Jesus. Jesus, in him is life and breath. In him is healing. In him is salvation. In him is deliverance. In him there's life and peace and joy. Whatever you need this morning, it's all found in the name of Jesus. Jesus, we call out to that name. Jesus, for my children, for my family, Jesus, for my city, my God, Jesus, for my country, my Lord, for my world. We speak the name of Jesus. Speak the name of Jesus. As we speak the name of Jesus, do you feel the atmosphere change when we begin to speak the name of Jesus? In faith, believing, we speak your holy name. Whatever need that you're feeling right now, come on, would you just reach out? Would you just reach out? It's a free gift that he gives. We just have to be willing and reach out. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Do not pass me by, my Jesus. Do not pass us by, my Lord. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. Hallelujah. I love to be in the presence of the Lord. Whew, there's nothing like being in his presence. Amen. We can go through our day taking care of responsibilities. We have jobs, many of us. We have responsibilities, but nothing compares to being in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We're so thankful that each of you are with us this morning. We have several guests. We have several members who are missing because of sickness. Amen. And we miss them and we pray for them. But we're so thankful that our guests are with us this morning. Amen. Brother Thomas, we missed you last week because we weren't here, but you were here. Amen. So good to see you again this morning. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. And I know that we have Sister Roaming and Sister Ben Cosme's co-worker is here this morning. Amen. We're so grateful to see her. Amen. And her family, her husband, who is a pastor, their ministers. Amen. Their family, so grateful. We're only sorry that Sister Christine wasn't here able. She was scheduled to, but poor little Gideon woke up with a fever. So what that means is you just have to come back. That's all that means. Amen. So grateful that you all are with us this morning. Amen. What a beautiful presence of the Lord. I'm so thankful for the Lord. I'm so thankful for His Spirit. It makes all the difference. Amen. All the difference in the world is to just be able to call on the name of Jesus and know who He is. Many people say His name, but they don't really know who He is. Many people call on that name thinking they know about Him, and they do know about Him. But to have that relationship with Him where you know Him personally, amen, that's a whole new world, and I'm thankful for that experience. And if you have not had that experience, today is the day. And then today is the day for that experience. We want to share with you in our bulletins. We have some announcements to share coming up. If you have a bulletin, wonderful. If not, they should be showing up on the screen. We were supposed to have a baptismal service this morning. Pastor shared in the 10 o'clock Sunday school lesson that he had visited a couple who on Thursday, they both wanted to come this morning to be baptized in Jesus' name. However, the husband was put in the hospital yesterday and reached out and said he's not able to make it. And so we're praying for them. When he gets out, they will come and they will be baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. We have a missionary that is scheduled to be with us this coming Wednesday. So we want to take up a special offering. It's missionary and his family, the Wicket family, missionaries to Fiji and the Solomon Islands. They're actually headed back there. They're actually packing their bags, and we are their last visit before they go. So we're not certain if they're going to be able to make it to us on Wednesday or not, but we do want to invest into the work in the Pacific. So please, you can give through Zelle or you can give in person. Just mark Missionary Wicket. That's it, Missionary Wicket, that you would like to give. Also, we have a special service coming up on Wednesday, October 25th. Dr. Daniel Sirstad will be ministering. Please come on a Wednesday. Bring family members, bring guests to come and receive from him. And River of Life is also hosting a minister's breakfast on Saturday, October 28th. We will be serving local ministers. We need volunteers to help set up, serve the food, break down, and clean up. It's going to be Saturday morning, October 28th, 8 a.m. to 12 p.m. Please text your name, and I will help, to this number that is in the bulletin so that we can count on you. If we don't receive a text, we'll be calling. Amen. Jesus is calling, and so are we. Amen. October birthdays, we want to celebrate. Little Luke celebrates on the 8th. He's not here this morning, but we'll celebrate with him. Madison has a birthday on the 13th. We'll celebrate with Maddie. Brother Anthony has a birthday on the 15th. We celebrate with Brother Anthony. Brother Miguel on the 18th. We celebrate with him. Brother Jeremiah, who plays the keyboard every other Sunday, he celebrates on the 23rd. And Maggie on the 26th will celebrate a birthday. We're so happy to celebrate our birthdays together. Amen. If you are able, would you please stand as we get ready to bring our tithe and offering to the Lord and pledge unto God. The pledge is in your bulletin, and if you do not have a bulletin, the pledge should be showing up on the screen for all of us to pledge together, all based out of the Word of God. Amen? Amen. Let's pledge. Upon the authority and by the orders of your Word, I have given, and it shall be given to me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither and giver, and I bring my tithe and offerings today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates, returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts dismissed, royalties received. My greatest desire is that my whole family will be saved, walking with God in perfect health and abundance, and walking in divine favor and blessings. I shall be blessed going in. I shall be blessed going out. And all that I do will prosper. In Jesus' name, amen. It is so. Please come bring your tithe and offering to the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Our God is greater.
Turn into wine, open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine.
Hallelujah. How many of you believe that He is awesome? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How many of you know that He's a healer? Amen. 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 Praise God. I'm going to ask my visiting pastor, hallelujah, amen, to come up and just greet the congregation and tell us a bit about his family, hallelujah.
Bless him, Jesus.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Come on, you can do better than that. Give God some praise. Yes. We're in the house of the Lord. If you're not incapacitated, can you stand to your feet and give God some praise? He's truly a worthy God. He's a good, good Father. Come on, give your God some praise. Glory be to God. Glory be to God. I said, glory be to this God. There's none like him. Hey, Osaba. Hey! We bow in honor to you, Daddy. We bow in honor to you. You are a good, good Father. He's a good, good Father. Saints, I said, he's a good, good Father. One that sticketh closer than a brother.
Yes, he is.
When all hell is breaking loose. My God, I had some news over the course of last week. And when the enemy came in to mess up my heart, to mess up my mind, he just said, stand still, my son. Calm your nerves. I'm still on board. I might be sleeping, but follow my lead. Sleep and rest in some situation. We don't need to get angry and mad about some situation. Learn to sleep through some situation. God, if the master is resting, why shouldn't I be resting? Ah, oh, he's a good father.
Yes.
Let me not get ahead of myself. Oh my God, every time I talk about this God. Today, this morning, my wife and I were up talking about the goodness of God. We're going to the Word. We're just talking and praying for others, family members that's going through. I'm going to tell you, I found out about this God. He's truly, truly awesome, saints of God. Prove him now. Try him now. And I guarantee you, there's certainly no failure in this God. Celebrate this God. Oh, my God. There's something about knowing this God. Thanks be to God. It's truly a pleasure to worship among you today. My wife and I, we just came out. My wife, that's Tavin. Me, and trust me, that's my partner. That's my friend. That's my confidant. I thank God for the woman he gave to me. Because
yes.
I've tried choosing some things for myself. But when God presented this one to me, I'm so happy that he blessed me with a partner, a friend, one I can lean and trust on 100%.
Come on. Yes.
You know, I just thank God for her. Every now and again, I say, honey, it's time for us to make a shift, to make a move. And I said, okay, what is God saying, honey? I said, go to this church, visit this church, go to that church. You know, and today, yesterday she said to me, honey, God is leading me to come to this church to visit. So I said, okay, baby, whatever God is saying, that's what we're going to do. Because one thing we try to be is to be obedient to the voice of God.
Amen.
Because if I mess up down the road, it's God's fault, it's not mine. It's upon God as long as I'm in obedience to him. Anything that happened, as long as I'm in obedience,
yes.
It's up on God to fix, to work out, to do whatever he chooses to do. Amen? So I'm saying I thank God. So we try our best to be obedient to this voice. You know, so here we are today. You know, my wife and our kids, that's Tahira, Tahalia, and little Hanson. Man, I tell you, that's God is just, it's amazing. Hanson's 2 years old. God promised my wife many years ago, before we even met, many years ago, that she would have a son. You know, and when Anthony came, and he was something else. From in the belly, he was something else, you know. It was truly a blessing, and he's very active. But it keeps us steadfast and going to God because he's the purpose of God. And I tell the saints of God, I encourage each and every one of you, make sure you have a relationship with this God. Don't wait until situation come. Know him now. So when the situation comes, you know it's easier to go to him. So the enemy will have you going any way, you understand, like those palm trees through the wind. Make sure you know him now. So when things come, you can know to stand still and hold your ground. The word declared that rust not against flesh and blood, but principles and powers. So to understand the fight, that there is a fight. There's a war to be fought. And we got to fight the good fight of faith.
Amen.
Amen. It's time for us to understand, church. It's time to fight back. We should not stand up and allow the enemy to do any old thing. It's time to fight back. Fight through prayer. Fight through your worship. Fight through your praise. But fight back for your family. Fight back for your community. Fight back for the schools. It's time to fight back. We're waging war on this enemy. because it means us no good. It's time. Oh, boo! Sataba! Echo!
Jesus! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! It's time to fight back. Church, I encourage you, whatever the situation is, don't let it get you down. Stand up and put on your armor and say, let's go, devil. Let's go. I'm not backing up or backing down. I'm fighting for what God said is mine. It's time to fight back. God never just send them into the promised land just like that. They have to fight for what's theirs. So fight for what's yours, saints of God. Fight with all your heart. But make sure I have a relationship with this God. Amen. Be blessed. Love you and thank you. And I must say, when I walk in this sanctuary today, I felt the love. I felt the warmth. I felt the Holy Spirit. And I said, thank you. Keep the fire of God going. Keep the fire of God going. Be blessed in Jesus' name. Again, my name is Pastor Curry. I never know if I'm so sorry. I'm Pastor Curry. I'm so sorry. Pastor Curry from New Life Deliverance Center Church of God, where my bishop is Bishop DaCosta. And we're just happy to celebrate with you. Amen. I told him, Bishop, we're going to worship at church. They want to leave at 12:30 and come to our church. Amen. Amen. So be blessed. And thank you very much for having us.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Amen. So I may keep him up here and let him preach. Hallelujah. Amen. Good having them today. Amen. Amen. Well, if you missed the Sunday school lesson, it was on grace. As we demonstrated God's gift, that free gift of grace, but you can only receive it if you have an open hand to receive it. Today I had prepared a lesson thinking that we're going to have a couple guests who are going to be baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. But he had to go to the hospital. We want to continue to pray for Joe and his wife, Wendy, as they go through this cancer battle. Pray for Mike, Marcia, Chris is here, Gideon, the two Bell children, and Pastor Morgan and others who have this flu, this virus going around. Also, I don't see Sister Blossom, so she must also be battling with that. So let's pray right now. Heavenly Father, Hallelujah. We trust in that name which is above every name, the grace of healing. Lord, we want to receive that grace of healing right now. By grace, God, you have made a way for us to be healed, trusting in your word. Let us claim it. Let us receive it in that mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. And amen. And amen. Amen. Thank you, music. Amen. What a sweet spirit we feel here today of worship. Amen. I'm going to continue with grace. To receive a gift, you must have an open hand to receive it. I'm going to start with Amos chapter 5, verse 15. And I'm going to read two versions, the King James Version and another version, just to help us get a better understanding of the scripture. In the King James Version, it says, hate the evil. We ought to hate evil. We ought to hate evil. Y'all hear me? Let's all stand, amen, for the reading of the word. We ought to hate evil because of God's grace and love the good. We ought to love good. If we have God's grace working in our life, we ought to hate evil and love the good and establish judgment in the gate and be, what's this, and may be that the Lord God of hosts be gracious. God is a gracious God. He is presenting to us a free gift of grace. Another version reads it this way. Amos will urge the people to repent and walk the right way with the hope that God of hosts will be gracious to them. To receive grace, you've got to open your hand and receive it. Grace is not just there for us to ignore his word. So when his word comes, that is grace. Grace is the word of God. Grace gave us the plan of salvation. Grace gave us his word to apply it to our lives. And so if you would turn with me to Luke chapter 24:47, it says, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name. What's his name? In the name of Jesus. Jesus means Jehovah became our salvation. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name, the name of Jesus, among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Lord, help me today get across this topic of grace, how to receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Acts chapter 3, verse 19. We have grace. It is a free gift, and nobody is saved without grace. It's his grace that even gave us an opportunity to be saved. Because God could sit up on his throne and he could destroy each and every one of us. Every time we did something wrong, he could just go, poof, I'm done with them. I'm going to create another one. And if they do something wrong, I'm just going to curse them and cast them into the lake of fire. I'm not going to have any plan for them. I'm not going to give any grace. But because of God's grace, he said, I'm coming off my throne. I'm going to wrap myself in the flesh. I'm going to become the lamb. I'm going to become the sacrifice so that they can have a plan. Acts chapter 3, 19. He would not write it in his word if it wasn't important. Repent, ye therefore. God's grace is saying, hey, I give you a word. If you will repent, you can receive my grace. It's like when I was handing out the money and the snacks to the kids, the ones that didn't want to come and raise their hand and lift out their hand, they didn't receive the free gift. They could have received it, but the ones that came and handed out their hand and they received it, it was free. It didn't cost them anything, but they had to do something. So I know that it's not by our works that we are saved. We cannot work our way into salvation, but we do have to do something. We have to believe and we have to respond to the word of God. The grace that God gave us, he gave us his word. And he says, repent ye therefore, and what? Be converted. My grace wants you to repent, change, and be converted. Stop hating good and living for evil. Hate evil and come and live for good. Be converted. My grace is allowing this. My grace is not there just for you to ignore me. My grace is there. Here, if you would start hating evil and begin to love good and convert yourself, that's my grace. Repent ye therefore and be converted. Why? Why should we be converted, brothers and sisters? For your sins may be blotted out. God's grace says, if you come, hallelujah, and you repent, I'm going to blot out your sins. I'm going to change you. I'm going to wash you. I'm going to cleanse you. That's God's grace. Repent therefore and be converted that your sins may be blotted out. When the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Glory to God. This is your refreshing. When you will come and believe and hold out your hand and receive the word of God, respond to the word of God, hate evil, love good, hallelujah, turn from your wicked ways, glory to God, and what? You're going to receive a refreshing. You're going to receive my spirit. It's going to change everything, hallelujah. You're going to speak with new tongues, hallelujah. If you look in the Old Testament, even in the Old Testament, 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, there's grace there, but you got to come and you've got to respond to receive it. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and what? Pray. And seek my face. And then, after they pray, they humble themselves. They're going to have to turn from their wicked ways. What is that? That means repent. That means, God, I'm sorry that I got caught and I want to change. Not just, I'm sorry I got caught. Oh, hallelujah. I want to be converted. I want to be changed. I don't want to just say I'm sorry because I got caught. I want to change. I don't want to do that anymore. I don't want to be like that. I want to follow after God. I want God's grace to live in my life. And they turn from the wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin. God wants to extend grace. He wants to forgive you of your sin, but He can't forgive you if you don't humble yourself, pray, seek His face, and turn from your wicked ways. And then He can heal your land. Then He can heal you. Then He can heal your mind. He can heal your family. He can heal your soul. He can heal whatever's bothering you. Hallelujah. But you got to receive that grace by applying the Word of God. And you got to humble yourself. And you got to turn from your wicked way. And you got to pray to God. And let God, who is a merciful God, who is a God that wants to extend grace. God's grace is a free gift if you extend your hand to receive it. Ezekiel chapter 18, 21 says it this way. In the King James Version, it says, but if the wicked will turn, if the wicked will turn from all of their sins, hallelujah, watch this, that they have committed. You did it. You committed it. It was you. If the wicked would turn from their wicked ways that they have committed. Watch this. And here it is. God's grace, I'm going to give you a plan. If you do this, then you can receive my grace. He says, and you keep all my commandments, my statutes, and do that which is lawful and that which is right. Hallelujah. Well, I'm saved by God's grace. Hallelujah. I don't have to do anything. No, God says, to receive grace, you're going to have to change. You're going to have to stop sinning. Keep my commandments. Do that which is right. And then you shall surely live and you will not die. He's talking about eternal. He's talking about you're going to live eternally. Not in the carnal nature, but in the spiritual nature. If we learn to trust God and we turn from our wicked way and we apply grace, we receive grace. Hey, we're still human. We still make mistakes, but grace now abounds more. But you can't receive grace until the old man dies. Just like the law of the Israelites. A woman can't be married to another man until he dies. And God's telling the church that you can't be married to him and you can't make it to heaven until you die to the old person. My grace is there. I want everybody to receive it. My grace is there, but you have to hold out your hand and receive it. You have to do something. It's not by our works that we're saved, but there's got to be a handout. We've got to tap into God's grace. Grace is the answer to our prayers. Grace is the answer in His Word. We find in the next scripture here that we want to go over, Luke chapter 13, verse 3, in the King James Version says, I tell you nay, but except ye repent. Except ye repent, ye shall likewise perish. In other words, God's saying, I'm a graceful God. I'm a merciful God. I'm a loving God. I'm a kind God. I've given you a plan. If you repent, is that too much for us to do? Is that too much for us to do? I want to repent. I want to turn from my wickedness. I don't want to serve sin anymore. I want my mistakes and my sin to have a purpose now. Instead of me serving my sin, I want now, hallelujah, to serve God in the grace that God extended to me. I tell you nay, but except you repent, you shall also likewise perish. And this comes from a God who has extended grace. In Acts chapter 17:30, the apostles are on the mission. They're now doing what God told them to do. And we see in verse 30, in the times of this ignorance of God, that God used to wink at ignorance, but now commandeth all men everywhere to repent. To repent. He commanded everybody everywhere to repent. I've got something free for you. I got grace for you. It's free. It's right here. You can receive it. But likewise, you need to repent. You need to change. You need to stop loving evil and hating good. You need to love good and hate evil. Do that which is right in the sight of God. And then we see here, grace is the answer to salvation. Grace tells us how to be saved. In the book of Acts chapter 2, 37, 38, and 39, now when they heard this, when they heard the preaching, Brother Romig, when they heard the good news, when they heard the message that God told the apostles to preach and to teach, after they go and they said, this is what the Lord says, hallelujah, repent. Now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, and they said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brother, what shall we do? Somebody get this. Think about this. Peter and the rest of the apostles, they spent time with Jesus. He told them, he commanded them what to go preach, what to go teach. He told them in the Gospels what to do, and now they're relaying the message of what he told them to preach. And they came and said, what do we do to be saved? And then Peter gives the answer. Remember, Peter is the one that has the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Whatever he preaches, whatever he teaches, whatever he does, Jesus said, I'm with you. Whatever you preach on earth, hallelujah, I'm going to back it up in heaven. Hallelujah. You have the keys to the kingdom of God. In other words, I'm going to build my church on whatever you preach. This is my grace. I'm giving grace because I'm going to give this man the anointing. I'm going to give him the words. And what he preaches, I'm standing behind in heaven. So go ahead and preach it, brother. You are the rock. I'm building my church, not literally building the church on his back, but what he says, what he does. Hallelujah. And here's what he said. If you want grace, woo! If you want my grace, you're going to have to repent. Woo. Here's what Peter said. He said, repent and be baptized. Well, can I just believe? No, you need to believe, and you need to hand out your, listen, put your hand out and receive this message. You need to repent. And what do you do? Listen, what is repent? That's a dead person. I'm dying to myself. I'm dying to the old nature. I'm dying to the flesh. I'm dying to the flesh and sin nature that I have. And I'm going to do what? I'm going to bury it. Hallelujah. When somebody is dead, they bury them. Repent. Die to yourself. Die to your sin nature. And be baptized, every one of you, in the name. I don't want to mess with anybody, but it said in the name. In the name of Jesus Christ. Why? For the remission of your sins. When you repent and you die, you're buried with him. You're taking on his name because he died for you. He became the sacrifice. He became the substitute. He became the little lamb. Hallelujah. And he shed his blood. And you're taking on his name in burial with him. And you're dying like he died. Hallelujah. And you're burying that old man. And you're taking on his name. He said, go in my name. name. He said, I'm sending the Father, hallelujah, in my name. He said, I'm sending the Holy Ghost in my name. I come in my Father's name. What name? What is the name? I baptize every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ. You see, the apostles, they heard the command. The Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they say what Jesus said, and they always said the name of the Father, name of the Son, name of the Holy Ghost, in His name. Who are they talking about? They're talking about Jesus because He's given the command, and in the book of Acts is the action of the apostles, and now the apostles are going, and they're doing what He was commanding them to do. So now we don't see them repeating what they said, He said, but they're obeying it. They're taking action and they're doing it in His name. That name which is above every name, at every what? Every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ. So I'm going to baptize them in His name. I'm not baptizing in His titles. I'm not saying in the Almighty. I'm not saying in the Prince of Peace. I'm not saying, hallelujah, glory to God, in the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, and the ending. I'm not saying in our Savior. I'm saying in His name. Hallelujah. I am a father. I am a son. I am a husband. Hallelujah. I am a pastor. But my name. If I tell you to do something in my name, you're going to use my name, not my titles. If I write you a check and I sign it, Father, they're not going to cash it. If I sign it, the Son, they're not going to cash it. If I say, the preacher, they're not going to cash it. I better write my name. Say amen. Because the command was to do it in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. And we know what His name is. There is no other name given whereby we must be saved but the name of Jesus, Jehovah, who became our salvation. Glory. God Himself wrapped Himself in the flesh. He became the sacrifice. He became the substitute for our sins. That's grace. That's grace. Grace is that He did that. Grace is that now I'm going to give you the plan of salvation. You're going to have to die. You're going to have to be buried and take on my name. And I'm going to resurrect you and fill you with my Spirit. And you're going to speak in new tongues as the Spirit gives you the utterance. It's not something you can do on your own. You have to what? You have to receive it. And when the Holy Ghost fell on them, and they all began to speak in tongues as the Spirit gave them the utterance. Hallelujah. How? They had to receive it. They had to have open hands. God doesn't force His Spirit on somebody that doesn't want it. So then Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Who's this promise to? For the promise is unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. So what does that mean? That means it's for all of us. It's not just for the apostles. It's not just for their children. It's for all of us. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they all end with amen, which means it's done. It's cold. It's finished. You go to the book of Acts and you end with the last chapter of the book of Acts, it doesn't say amen. You know why? Because it's a continuation. It's still going. It's still happening. People are still being baptized. People are still being filled with the Holy Ghost. People are still receiving grace. Hallelujah. Hey, as many that will. My God. Hallelujah. Sister Pat, I didn't give you, maybe I did, Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Acts chapter 4, verse 12. Amen. I just want to make sure everybody sees this. Neither is there salvation in any other. There is no salvation in any other. For there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Who are they talking about? How do you know that? Well, let's back up. Sister, go to verse 1, and we're going to walk it on down. Watch this. And as they spoke or spake unto the people and the priests and the captains and the temple and the Sadducees, and watch this, came upon them. Here we go. Watch this. Being grieved that they taught the people and priests what? Through what? What name are they talking about? The name of Jesus. Through the resurrection of the dead. Watch this. Verse 3. And they laid hands on them. Not. They didn't lay hands on them and say, I'm going to heal you, bro. I'm going to heal you, bro. No, they laid hands on them to take them and put them in jail. And it was evening time. And they put them in the jail. Why? Because they were preaching Jesus. Verse 4, howbeit many of them heard the word, believed, and a number of the men was about 5,000. How many women and children? Probably more. Isn't that how church works? There's always more women and children than there are men. It's kind of sad. Hallelujah. Verse 5, and it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes came in verse 6. You know, when people don't take on the name of Jesus, they're just a bunch of rulers and scribes, and they got a bunch of titles, and they got a bunch of positions, and they got a bunch of law, and they got a bunch of this and that. But the power is in the name. The name of Jesus, Jehovah, who became our salvation. And then Ananias, the high priest, and go through all that. I want to get down to verse 7 or 8. Go to verse 7. And when they had set them in the midst, and they asked them, By what power and by what name have you done this? What did they do? They prayed for a sick man, an impotent man, and he laid his hands on him, and he was healed, and he was delivered. And they said, by what power and by what name did you do this? Verse 8. Then Peter filled with the What? Peter filled with the Holy Ghost. Hey, let me say something. If you want God's grace, God has given his grace, and you too can repent. You too can be baptized in Jesus' name. You too can be filled with the Holy Ghost like Peter. Why wouldn't you want God's grace? Why wouldn't you want the power of the Holy Ghost? We got a lot of people that don't want the Holy Ghost. They don't think that they need the Holy Ghost. Why wouldn't you want the Holy Ghost? Why wouldn't you want the Holy? Why wouldn't you want every gift that God could give you? It's free. All you got to do is hold out your hand and say, I want it. Man, I want everything God has. Because God is good. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said to them, ye elders, rulers and elders of the people of Israel. Watch this. Verse 10 goes on. Be it known to y'all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. They were specific. So when we say in the name, we're saying in the name of Jesus the Christ, the Messiah, the one that came, who was a Nazarene, the one that was born in a manger. It's the name of Jesus, Jehovah, who became our salvation. There is no other Savior. There was none before him. There's not going to be any after him. Hallelujah. He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. He is the end. Hallelujah. And he said in Colossians chapter 3:17, sister, Colossians 3:17, I just feel the Holy Ghost on this one. Glory to God. Colossians 3:17, and whatsoever you do, whatsoever you do, do it all in the name of Jesus. It's in Jesus' name. If I cast out devils, it's in Jesus' name. If I pray for the sick, it's in Jesus' name. When I baptize, how you think I'm going to pray? In Jesus' name. Glory to God. There is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved but the name of Jesus Christ. We preach Jesus. There is no other name. He has other positions. He has many titles. He's the rock. He's the fortress. He's the Prince of Peace. He's everlasting. He's mighty. Hallelujah. Come on, throw some more out. He's my refuge. He's my wonderful. He's the counselor. The light, the lamb. He's got all kinds of positions and titles, but his name is the only name whereby we can be saved, but by the name of Jesus. It comes by grace. Grace says, here, I'm going to give you a way to be delivered. I'm going to give you a way to be set free. I'm going to give you the plan of salvation. Sister, go ahead and put up another scripture up there, whatever I have on that list there. Stay with the book of Acts, the action of the apostles. I was really hoping that Joe and Wendy would be here today, but I understand he has cancer. And when they give him this treatment, it makes him very weak and sick, and it puts him in the hospital. There it is, Mark 16:15. And he said to them, go into all the world and what? Preach the gospel to every living creature. What's going to happen after that? Verse 16. That's all right. Amen. We're closing here in just a minute. Verse 16, 17, 18. Amen. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not, you're not getting the grace. What's it say? You're already condemned. You're already damned. Why? Grace was there. If you believe and you stick out your hand to receive it, you're going to receive it. But if you don't want to receive it and you want to put your hands down, you're not going to receive it. You're going to be condemned. You're going to be damned. Why? Because you didn't receive grace. Grace is there. God's grace is there for everybody. But you got to open up your hand to receive it. Verse 17, and these signs shall follow them. Woo! I love that. And these signs shall follow them that believe. When you believe and grace is extended, there's something that happens. It's not just, well, I'm saved. No, signs are going to follow you that believe and receive. In my name, whose name? Who are they talking about? Jesus was speaking, in my name, Jesus, they shall cast out devils. We can have the power to cast out devils in Jesus' name. And we can have that if you really believe it. Don't try it if you don't believe it. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall speak with new tongues. That's God's grace. We wouldn't have that power. We could not do that without God's grace. There's no way that we could speak in a new tongue without God's grace. Hallelujah. Glory to God. It's God's grace that he filled you with the Holy Ghost, and you began to speak in another tongue as the Spirit gave you the utterance. It's not by your might. It's by the power of the anointing of Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And God's grace. It's not something you can teach. It's not something you can train somebody to do. You can't say, repeat after me. Go like this. Ha ba 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 ha ba ha ba ba. No. It doesn't work that way. You are going to speak in a new tongue when you repent and when you receive God's grace and you go down in His name and you take on His name and He fills you with His Spirit. And the evidence that you're born again is you're going to speak in a new tongue that you didn't know, you didn't learn, you didn't know what, you don't even know what you're saying except you're praising God. Verse 18. They shall take up serpents. And if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And they shall lay hands on the sick, and the sick shall recover. Notice what he did not say. He did not say, go get a bunch of snakes and handle them to prove that you have faith. No, they were going on a mission trip, and they were going through areas where if they came across a snake and they got bit by a snake because they're on the mission of God, it's not going to hurt them or harm them because they're on God's mission and nothing can harm them. He did not say, go get snakes and handle them and put it in front of everybody, prove that you have faith. Say amen. Let's stand. God's grace. We can't be saved without His grace. But we also can't receive His grace without putting our hands out to receive it. These altars are open. If you want to receive grace of any kind, if you need healing, if you need encouragement, if you need to change, if you need to give God something, if you've made a mistake, if you've thought bad things, you want to get rid of evil and you want to be converted, hallelujah. Listen, these altars should be for everybody. A lot of people are afraid to come to the altar because they think everybody's going to look at them like they did something. We all did something wrong. We all need something. We all need something from God. I don't know why everybody doesn't come to the altar and extend your hands and receive grace. A lot of you are just like these children. I say, come, I got a free gift. They don't want it. There's some of you here today that God has a gift for you, a free gift. All you got to do is come up here, extend your hand, and receive it. But no, your pride gets in the way. Or you're worried about what somebody's going to think of you if you go to the altar. Somebody's looking at me. You see, we understand a child. You know, it's fearful to be in front of people looking at you. I understand that. It's the toughest job in the world to get up here and speak in front of people. It's scary. But God's saying, if you'll just come, I have grace. Whatever you're going through this morning, Pastor, whatever you're going through, whatever situation is, God's grace says, I'm going to see you through it. I'm going to give you the power to fight. You're going to put on the full armor of God. You're going to put on the helmet of salvation. You're going to put on the breastplate of righteousness. You're going to take the shield of faith. You're going to take the word, the sword of God, and you're going to put truth around your belt. Hallelujah. And you're going to wear peace to fight the enemy of your soul. God's grace. You know, I was handing out money and candy this morning. I ran out. But God doesn't run out. God is overflowing with grace. If you have devils need cast out, come. If you have sickness, come. If you have a need, come. If you need to restore your faith, come. If you need to feel the presence of God, come. If you want to speak in tongues, come. If you want to ask God to forgive you of your mistakes, come. Whatever it is, yeah, your shortcomings, your weaknesses, God says come. The Apostle Paul said, I am what I am because of grace. We are not anything without grace. It's God's grace that He gave us the Bible. Basic instruction before leaving earth. He gave us a roadmap. He gave us the answers, but it's because of His grace. Now, this is just one sermon. This is just one lesson. The Bible said in John said, man, there's so much that God did that we can't even tell you everything. You can't even contain Amen. It. We can't even write it all in words. You wouldn't even be able, the world wouldn't be able to contain it. God's grace. Would you lift up your hands? Would you receive it, whatever it is that you have need of this morning? Man, sir, whoever's watching live, just extend your hands and receive God's grace. Ma'am, sir, if you're watching at a later date after the recording, why don't you just lift up your hands and just extend your hands to God. I want to receive that grace. I got to receive your grace. I need your grace, God. I need your grace, God. Hallelujah, whatever you're going through. Some of you have cancer. God's grace. He wants you to repent. Cancer is not just your fault because of your sin. Cancer is the fault of sin that entered in when sin came through Adam and Eve. When Adam and Eve sinned against God, that's when sickness and disease and hurt and tribulations and pain and sweat and giving birth, all those things entered in because of sin. It's not just your sin, it's mankind's sin. Won't you lift up your hands if you have cancer? If you have the flu, if you have COVID, if you have a liver disease, if you have a heart condition, if you have a back condition, if you have an emotional condition, hallelujah, if you have a financial situation, if you're struggling in an area that you don't understand, give it to God. His grace, His grace, His grace, His grace, His grace, His grace. He will tell you what to do. And His grace, listen, His grace is what instructs you. to be stronger, to grow, to conquer, to trust Him. I'm telling you, His grace is what gives you strength. It's His grace that will help you in every season of your life. He will help you in your marriage. He will help you in your family situation. He will help you in your health. He will help you in your careers because of His grace. But we have to extend our hands. You notice that we're supposed to raise our hands as we're extending, like we want something. We're surrendering to God. Lord, I thank You for Your grace. Lord, let me receive it. Let me receive it. Let me receive it. Don't let me hinder Your word by ignoring Your word, by disobeying Your word. His word's there for you. It's there for your blessing. It's there to get revelation. It's there to increase your knowledge. It's there to increase your wisdom of what to do. The knowledge of knowing what the situation is, the problem, and the wisdom to know what to do to conquer it. Naaman, go down in the muddy Jordan River 7 times and dip 7 times. Why? That's the knowledge that you have something and the wisdom of what to do to get the cleansing. Joshua, march around the city of Jericho. I don't want you doing it, just march. I want you to do it 7 times. And then I want you to shout and blow the trumpets. That's wisdom from heaven. That's how you conquer. Grace is extended. Will you receive it? Jesus is telling you something today. Just do it. Just do it. Hallelujah. Amen. Good to have Thomas with us and his guest, and good to have our family here visiting, Pastor. Amen. I got to get the name down again. I already forgot the name, but so glad that you're here. Everybody knows who I'm talking about. Amen. We're glad that you're all here. We had a lot of people not here today, and we're praying for them. We know that God's going to extend His grace to them, and they're going to be healed. Hallelujah. And they'll be back soon in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 If you need to keep praying, keep praying. If you want to show yourself friendly, meet and greet one another in Jesus' name. And remember, October is a busy month. We've got a lot of things going on. We need volunteers for our breakfast to serve ministers. We've got a lot going on. Dr. Daniel Surstadt is going to be with us on that Wednesday night before he ministers to the ministers. Amen. So be ready for October. God bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Happy birthday to all you October birthdays. Amen.